Something messed up. Didn't play the beginning of the intro. We're doing that again. Okay, it played crappily, but to hell with it. Let's play it one more time. Nah, I'm kidding. We're not going to do that again. All right, everyone. Hello. Good evening. Welcome to Hate Live, my ongoing podcast, which I try to do weekly. I don't always do weekly. Sometimes I do it bi-weekly. Sometimes I do it once a month. Sometimes I do it once every 4 years. I don't know. But welcome. Tonight is Thursday, January 8th, 2015. January 8th. Doesn't it feel like the new year just happened? Like, where did this past week go? Pretty wild, right? But anyway, welcome to the stream and welcome to the podcast. We actually have a lot going on. This particular podcast is going to be info-centric. And what I mean by that is sometimes I have themed podcasts where, oh, it's the holidays, we'll talk about this. Oh, we're going to talk about advertisements, we're going to talk about this. No, this podcast is actually going to be completely chock full of info. There will be a few opinions here and there, but for the most part, I have so much to talk about in regards to updates on stuff that we've been talking about for weeks. We've got the forums and the website that are fully functional. We've got the integration of Patreon. If I can't even say it, I don't know how I'm going to integrate it. We've got wrestling news. Basically, the bottom line is this. I haven't really had a chance to do a lot of stuff that I've wanted to do recently. In regards to things, and I want to just get you guys up to speed. If you remember before, I used to do the podcast and the live streaming, it used to be, oh, I have a channel update here, and I had smart guys to talk about wrestling here, and all that's kind of changed in the past couple of years. Hate Live has really become the main place where I kind of get you guys up to speed on what's going on with me, on my opinions on stuff, and that's going to be the primary focus of the show tonight. So to give you the outline and the summary of what to expect, we're going to open the show talking about what I've been doing recently gameplay-wise, what I've been doing with the year-end series, my overall reactions and your reactions so far, and how that's going to continue next week, all right? We're going to talk about some things that I still need for those series, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. Then we're going to talk a little bit about Patreon. I'm going to explain to you what is Patreon, why am I adopting it. I'm going to talk about some things that there have been misconceptions and confusion about the program and about why am I adopting it that I want to clear up. I've got great news in regards to Patreon that I want to talk about. And basically, it's all starting in the coming week or two. So I want to kind of explain everything fully on this podcast. All right, it's the Patreon Explanation Edition. We're also going to talk wrestling. Like I said, we haven't had an episode of Smark Guys, my wrestling commentary show, in quite a long time. And because of that, I have not been able to talk about wrestling. And I want to talk about wrestling tonight. I've watched the past 2 to 3 weeks of Monday Night Raw, and I have a lot to say. All right? So we're going to talk about that tonight. I'm going to get it off my chest, and there's going to be a major update when it comes to the future of Smark Guys. We're going to start talking about that tonight. I'm going to let you guys know. I've actually got some information in regards to world news that I want to just kind of brush over. I don't want to go too in-depth because a lot of it isn't even fully developed yet. We don't have full information, but I do want to touch upon it. And then we're going to have a small discussion segment in regards to the financial industry in the United States. What I mean by that is these past few years, since I became, you know, I like to say almost since I started doing YouTube and I moved out and got my own place in Connecticut and then I ended up getting this house in Washington, I've really become an adult. And I almost say that up to that point, it was kind of like the transitionary stages between becoming a teenager to being a young adult and becoming a full-fledged adult with all these responsibilities. And these past few years, I've had so many dealings with the United States financial industry that what I would like to do is talk to you guys about that and about, unfortunately, the one startling shortcoming that I found with the United States financial industry and everything that I try to do with them, and we're going to talk about that, okay? And then we're going to take a break. After the break, we're going to come back, and we're going to do something that I rarely do. We're going to do a full walkthrough of the new kingofhate.com. Now, if I remember correctly, a long time ago I did this. It might have been a year ago, but we're going to go to the new website. I'm going to show you the new homepage, walk you through all the features of how to tell Gene, this is Phil's schedule, and this is when he's doing this every day, and this is how you can use the playlist functionality to search for any video I've ever put on YouTube. Yes, that is now functional. I want to show you how fully functional that actually is. We're going to go on the forums. I'm going to show you all the different areas where I need your help with series coming up and things, if your feedback and your ongoing stuff, and all of that. Okay? So it's going to be a fully fledged, 100% jam-packed episode of Hate Live with so much info coming. I hope that it's not boring you. I hope that it's entertaining to you because it is a lot of new info that maybe you don't know about. Now, I do want to say this. There is no portion of Hate Live tonight that's going to be back in the day. That will return, okay? However, for now, I've got so much to talk about, I'd rather take my time to really stretch it out and talk enough about it that it's all understood, rather than me rushing through to tell a funny story and then going, oh, wait, well, I suppose there's the websites live and what's this and that? You know what I mean? Let's take an episode here to really kind of sit back and talk seriously about a lot of important stuff. And the next time we do Hate Live, we will maybe become more lighthearted and, you know, won't be as serious. That being said, you might say to yourself, well, wait a minute. Well, when is the next episode of Hate Live? Like, when will the next episode of Hate Live actually be? It's not going to be next week, because next week on Thursday, I actually have some guys coming to install a toilet in my master bathroom that's probably going to take all the afternoon when normally I would be doing my streaming, and because of that, I decided I'm probably not going to do any gameplay that day, and that night, I'll probably end up either just working on year-end series or doing something else, so more than likely, there's no Hate Live at all, and no podcast or anything, no vlogging next week on Thursday. I may just have the day off, technically, okay? In 2 weeks' time, 2 weeks from today... So that's going to be not the 15th of January, but that would be the 22nd of January, all right? We are going to be doing Ask the King. Yes, the first episode of Ask the King that I have done since October. Actually, I think it might have been late September. I'm not 100% on this because it's been so long. I'm going to show you tonight on the podcast where to go on the forums to post up questions for Ask the King. So I'm going to make sure there's no confusion. A lot of people ask the king, how do I ask questions? I just send them something on Twitter, right? That is one method, but it's not the best method. I'm going to show you the best method tonight. So again, a fully informative episode tonight. No Hate Live next week. In 2 weeks' time, it's Ask the King. So Hate Live really will return sometime in early February, I'm figuring. Okay? Okay. So now, let's talk. Let's talk about what I've been doing recently, what I'm going to be doing in the next week or two, and I want to get you guys up to speed on everything going on with my gaming schedule so that you know what to expect when, all right? So basically, this is the deal. The past few weeks, I've been busy continuing on all of the projects and all the gameplay, excuse me, and the playthroughs that I've been doing since December, including Dragon Age Inquisition, Kingdom Hearts 2 Final Mix, and now I just recently started Grand Theft Auto 5, the first-person shooter playthrough, meaning I'm playing that whole game on the PS4 in the first person. I'm continuing on with those for now. I just want you guys to understand, that's what you're going to see gameplay-wise for at least another week. Now, things are going to change come the week of January, what is it, 18th? The week of 18th through the 24th, because that week we finally have some new releases in the form of Saints Row 4, Get Out of Hell. We've also got the Resident Evil 1 reboot of the remake of the... It's so convoluted. Basically, they took the GameCube version of Resident Evil, which was already a remake of the original game, and they're remaking the remake in HD. I don't know if there's going to be even more content on top of it there or not, but I'm going to be checking that out. So that week, you're going to have two things going on in addition to, you know, everything else. So if I am continuing on those same playthroughs, they may go on hiatus for a few days for me to check out those two things until finally we get back to them, okay? And then the last week of January, we've actually got a significant amount of new content in the form of Dying Light, the Grim Fandango remastered release, and apparently episode 2 of Tales from the Borderlands are all coming out at the same time. So basically, the second half of January is going to be busy with new game releases paired with the ongoing releases, all right? What about my year-end stuff? Well, if you haven't been following along, I pity the fool because it's been good stuff. The past 2 weeks, I really put in a lot of time and effort, taking the second half of every single day, and instead of doing a second gameplay stream, I've been working on these year-end series. And so far, I've completed the best and worst DLCs of 2014, the most disappointing games of 2014, and I just started yesterday the worst gaming trends of 2014. And that's going to resume tomorrow, and hopefully, I get to finish that tomorrow, alright? I'm hoping that I actually get to finish the worst gaming trends because it would be great to finish off that series and not have it lingering over a weekend, alright? But there's still two more to go. That's right, we still have the Game of the Year awards and the funniest moments of the year montage that I'm going to work on. So, how is this going to work? Well, this coming weekend, I'm still going to be balancing all of these games that I'm playing. In fact, tomorrow, I'll just get it out there. Tomorrow, I'm playing Grand Theft Auto 5, the first-person shooter. Saturday, I'm doing more Kingdom Hearts 2 Final Mix. Sunday, I'm doing more Dragon Age. And then we resume on Monday with Grand Theft Auto, Tuesday, Kingdom Hearts, and Wednesday with Dragon Age. So, what I'm planning to do is hopefully by, say, middle of next week to be almost done with my Game of the Year awards. I want to start those on Monday, all right? So hopefully Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, the Game of the Year awards are almost done, if not completely done. And then hopefully by the end of the week, we could do the Funniest Moments montage, meaning next week should be the final week where I'm working on these year-end series. And that's a good thing for multiple reasons. Number one, it's already 2015, and people want to see those end and see new content start. Number two, because I have other content that I want to start. I want to start working on things like a movie-related vlogging series. I want to start working on Smark Guy, and yeah, we're going to talk about that a little bit later in the show. I want to start working on a new episodic show called Project 7, and I can't do that until I get past the year-end series, all right? So that's coming soon. Excuse me. All right, so that's the rough idea for the next week to 2 weeks. That's what you guys can expect, all right? Once the year-end series conclude, some days, undoubtedly on a day, if there's two games being released in January, I'll probably do two streams. I may do that for a couple days, but then I might balance that out with a day where I only do one stream and then I work on a vlog or I work on another series, okay? I really think that once this Project 7 gets off the ground, and you guys see the original creative vision that I had for it, what I had originally planned to do, the fact that it wasn't going to be just a raw video game playthrough. And keep in mind, I had this idea in 2010. I just want to remind everyone that. I started filming that in early 2010. And then it just got thrown by the wayside when I was too busy with my job to work on it. And I ended up starting to do this full time when I lost my job. And it was all about putting out videos and gameplay. And it wasn't about doing that creative kind of stuff anymore. When I rebooted Project 7 in late 2011, 2012, it was a completely different entity where I had these guys who wanted to do all these effects and all these crazy jokes and everything. And that really wasn't the core of what the series was going to be. It was supposed to be a really badly edited, cheesy, but still funny because it's independent and stupid kind of a series. And you're going to see what I mean when I finally get to it. I think you guys are going to like it, all right? But that can't start. I can't even start to brainstorm things for that until we're done with these year-end series. So we got to get through those, all right? So that's what's going to happen. Now, I have an alert. I need everyone's help for a few reasons. Number one, next week, as I said, I'm starting the Game of the Year Awards and the Funniest Moments of the Year. From what I can see, I really haven't had many submissions for logos and or splash screens or anything that I can use for those series. I've gotten plenty for the first 3 year-end series that I've worked on. I haven't really gotten much of anything, if anything, for those final two. So for those of you who have some graphic know-how, you like making logos, maybe splash screens, please, if you can throw something together and submit it on the forums, thekingofhate.com/forums. We're going to show you where to do that later in the show. So don't worry if you're, I don't use the forums, I don't know anything about it. I'm going to show you where to do that later in the show. But if you could whip something up, it's much appreciated. In addition to that, even if you don't have any kind of graphical know-how, I need your nominees for the Funniest Moments of 2014. Unfortunately, all of that data, all those hundreds of submissions that we had over the past year were lost when the previous forums crashed, all right? And because that happened, I have no data. I have no data of what to go on. Now, the good news is people have started to use the new forums in the past week. We've got about 500 registered users, and we've got about 35 to 40 people who posted up their nominees for the Funniest Moments. I need you guys to continue to do that. I know there's way more than 40 people out there who thought that something was funny in one of my videos in the year of 2014, and I really need you guys to jump on there and start nominating so that way I can pick the ones that I think are the funniest and put them into a really crazy fun montage for you guys, hopefully by the end of next week. All right. So I need your help with that. And I hope that you guys will jump on there and start to do that because I need it like ASAP. At this point, this weekend is the last chance because starting Monday, I may start the Game of the Year Awards. And if I do, I need all this stuff. OK, so thanks very much, everyone, for that. Now what I want to do before we move on to wrestling, where I'm going to vent a ton of shit and I'm going to be all pissed off or whatever. I know I am. Before we move on to that, what I'd like to do is talk to you about Patreon, what it is, my adoption of it. I want to explain what's going on fully so there's no... Because I know there's been some misconceptions over the past couple of weeks that I've been mentioning. I'm going to use Patreon. And a lot of people are saying, but Phil said he would never accept donations and stuff like that. I want to explain to you guys especially what Patreon is, how it works, all right? When I'm going to be using it, some good news regarding it. And I need your opinion and your feedback because I've been trying to get feedback from the forums. I've got some really good positive feedback, but I need more. I need more than just a few people who are posting on the forums. I need to know who you, the common viewer, what you think, and what you think I could give back to you if you were to become a Patreon of mine, all right? So let's get started. Let's completely reset here, and let's explain the situation so you know exactly what's going on, all right? I'll be honest with you, because you guys know I'm an extremely honest person. Back in 2008, I started making videos on YouTube as a hobby. It was completely independent from anything that I had thought that I was going to be doing as an ongoing thing. It was a complete shot in the dark. It wasn't like, oh, I'm going to become internet famous by putting videos on YouTube. Because the bottom line was no one really did that back then. In 2008, yeah, there were people who went viral. I still remember the guy who sang Chocolate Rain and stuff like that. A few people were getting popularity based off of what they did on YouTube. But it wasn't like people thought, oh, I can make a living if I just start making videos for YouTube. It was nothing like that at all. At the time, for a year, I'd been diagnosed with a pretty bad back injury. I wasn't able to do a lot of physical things. And I was trying to get back into gaming as a hobby because I knew this was something that was easy to do. I could sit on a couch and relax and do it. It wasn't a physical thing like football or driving long distances to attend video game tournaments like I used to, Street Fighter tournaments. I was trying to get back into gaming as a hobby and as a fun thing. And I got into it just for the hell of doing it and say, you know, I want to make gameplay videos, and if people care about them, they do. If they don't, they don't. And when I started, I had a shitty Sony digital camera that didn't even film widescreen, so it was propped on the side of my television, and the videos looked terrible, but people loved it because it was raw, unedited footage of me basically talking shit to games and failing in games and having fun with games. Street Fighter and other stuff, all that stuff was kind of included. And after doing it for like 6 months, it started picking up and getting popular on YouTube, which I never imagined would ever happen, right? So fast forward now to late 2010. In late 2010, I had gotten like popular on the internet. Every playthrough that I did was getting 20, 30,000, 40,000 views a video, which was out of control at the time. Everyone wanted to see Phil Burnell, Darkside Phil, play the hottest new games because it was like, wow, we get to see a Joe average guy. The guy's not very good at games, but he's funny when he fails, and we get to see him play the new games. We get to judge for ourselves whether or not the game's good. We get to have a good laugh with him as he does his stupid commentary, and it's a lot of fun, and we really enjoy this. And up to late 2010, basically things went swimmingly. Yeah, there were road bumps. Yeah, someone completely impersonated some third-party company and tried to shut down my YouTube channel, forcing me to make a new one. That's right, I had to go from the old Darkside Phil to the DSP Gaming channel and all that. But for the most part, up to late 2010, even though YouTube was very successful for me, I wanted it to just be a hobby. I always thought if I have a consistent 9-to-5 job, a desk job where I can have healthcare, a consistent salary, I don't have to worry about things like YouTube paying the bills or fluctuating views or performance or anything like that, because it's just my hobby that I do for fun. Cool that I have popularity for doing it, but I don't give a shit because I get to just do my 9-to-5 job, okay? Well, if only that had worked out, because I actually, in the year of 2010, had moved to a brand new condo that was literally 3 blocks away from my current office job at the time. I'd worked at that office job for almost 4.5 years, going on 5. I'd gotten multiple recommendations and commendations and all these awards and things from the company just for there to be a shift in management, and within 3 months of the shift in management, I got laid off. Now, I just want to give you guys some perspective. There's no jobs in Connecticut. Like, even today, in the job sector that I was working in, there's no jobs. The company that I worked for that laid me off in 2010 has laid off everyone in the company and is leaving Connecticut, is probably leaving the United States. That's how bad off they are, all right? So I got dumped, and I was like, this is completely out of left field. I didn't think, I mean, it was 4.5 years, all I got were commendations at my job. Did I think that I was going to get laid off? No, I didn't. It was just out of control. I couldn't believe it. And it sucked because I just bought a condo. You know what I mean? What was I going to do? How was I going to pay the bills? I did. I looked around, and as there's nothing in the job sector of what I was doing to get another job. And so I said, I'm going to do something crazy, something outside of the box, something different. And I'm going to attempt to do YouTube as a job. And I could go through all the details, I won't, but basically, later on in 2011, I got partnered with Machinima, and at that time, the partnership works like this. I still have the same partnership, it's just the terms have fluctuated a little bit, and I can't give you the exact amount, and I can't tell you how much I make. Obviously, all that's in a non-disclosure agreement that prevents me from doing that. I make videos on YouTube. You guys watch them. Based off of view performance, all right, I make a certain amount of money per my contract with Machinima. Machinima, in turn, puts ads on the videos and keeps all of the ad revenue. And we've had ups and downs. There were years where I made tons of ad revenue and years where YouTube ad revenue plummeted, and I ended up getting pay cuts. And that was kind of scary a couple years ago when that happened. I was like, oh, crap, now I'm going to lose money, right? And we've had ups and downs in viewership, right? Now, the latest development, all right, is basically this. For the past 2 years, I started live streaming daily, okay? I started direct capture daily. So the quality of my video content has skyrocketed. But primarily all I've been doing is gameplay, which means that the game reviews I used to do have been few and far between. The series and creative projects that I was used to do and stick in here and there kind of went away. And literally it became, gee, I'm going to watch Phil play games every day and that's it. And that's fine, but that gets stagnant after a while. It really does. I understand that. At one point, people were saying I was playing too many games, I was getting completely burnt out, and that it wasn't fun to watch me play them anymore, right? And I was like, well, geez, at some point that I'm going to have to reevaluate what I want to do. And early 2013, this is about a year ago now, I sat down and I said, I really need to reevaluate what I'm doing, because if I keep doing just straight gameplay, right, things are going to stagnate, and I'm going to lose a big chunk of my audience, because let's face it, now YouTube is blown up. Now everyone's known. There's so many people known for doing Let's Plays and playthroughs. Most people now aren't doing raw Let's Plays anymore. They're doing these hyper-edited ones, montages, or, you know, snippets here and there. They don't do the classic style start-to-finish raw Let's Play like I'm used to doing anymore. It's kind of gone by the wayside, and a lot of people have said we're just done watching full playthroughs. We'll watch little montages and snippets and comic skits and stuff like that, but we don't want to watch a full playthrough. Now, admittedly, there is still a big chunk of people who want to see me do that, which is great. And I'm not going to, you know, turn against those people. I want to have a balance. And in 2013, in early 2013, what I wanted to do, I even said this was one of my goals for the year, is I wanted to balance between gameplay and other stuff. And I tried adding new series like this podcast, Hate Live, and other things. But ultimately, the focus of the year, I'm sorry, I'm saying 2013 over and over, and I'm meaning to say 2014, by the way. I'm completely screwing this up. What I'm meaning to say is the year 2014, I wanted to balance the two, all right? And unfortunately, it didn't happen. And the reason it didn't happen in 2014 is because I got primarily focused on moving out of Connecticut. When I lived in Connecticut, the bills were insanely expensive. I'm talking the electric bill, the utility bills, taxes were more than twice as much as they are here in Washington State. I now have a house that's more than twice as big as I had in Connecticut, and I'm barely even paying what I paid in Connecticut for the old place. So I needed to get out of Connecticut. Connecticut was bleeding me dry. All right. And that was it became my main focus for 2014. And so halfway through 2014, I did move finally across the country, right? I got set up here. I bought all this new equipment to do the highest quality stuff or whatever, right? And I ended up going ahead and doing my same old thing, which for some people is fine, but let's face it. People were like, wow, Phil's going to move across the country. He's going to have a bigger house. Maybe this means he's going to do more creative stuff. He'll have more filming locations, like he said. And that didn't come to fruition simply because I spent so much time moving and furnishing the house and finally getting set up with the equipment and getting used to the stream set up and doing that. Next thing you know, the hardcore gaming season hit, and that was it. I was slammed to the end of the year. And so now here I am in 2015, and I find myself looking and saying, damn, I really wanted to start doing things differently in 2014, and I didn't, you know? From the outsider, from someone who wasn't maybe following along the fact that I was moving across the country and all this personal stuff was happening to me behind the scenes, and you look at just the content I put out in 2014, you say it was just the same old gameplay that Phil does all the time. And yeah, there were games, but there were few and far between great games last year, let's face it. And a year that's dried up and there's not as many great games means that there's not a lot of great stuff to watch me do. And I understand that, and I actually agree with that. After looking retrospectively back, I say, yeah, you know what? The bottom line is, you're right. Me just doing raw gameplay doesn't cut it in this day and age anymore, all right? I understand that. Here's the problem, though, and here's unfortunately where this is where the whole Patreon discussion comes into play. in mid-2014, when I did move across the country, there was a good 2 to 3 week period there where I wasn't live streaming. When I did come back and I started doing live streaming and gameplay, it was of like filler games for the summer. And I get the feeling a big chunk of people right there within that 1 to 2 months where it was really dead and there wasn't a lot going on kind of said, well, it was great while it lasted, but Phil's not really up to anything fun, so I'm going to move on. And it seemed like I lost a big chunk of my viewer base during that period of time. And you know, if I could have somehow continuously kept doing gameplay and doing interesting stuff during that period of time for you guys, I would have. The problem is, there was nothing to do. You know what I mean? I was playing the games that were out, they just weren't great. And I think it just caused this downward trend. And it never recovered. You know, the hardcore gaming season came. Let's face it, half the games that came out during that season weren't very good. The ones that were good, don't get me wrong, actually did pretty good performance-wise. Games like The Evil Within, Alien Isolation, a few others here and there mixed into that season that ended up being pretty good, did pretty good. But overall, it wasn't anywhere near like what I would usually get near the end of the year. And so, especially considering the fact that I just moved across the country, I do have a huge amount of debt on my back right now because I have to pay it off in order to, you know, I financed the whole move. I have to pay off all these finances. And the fact that people want to see me do stuff other than just play games, play games, play games, I kind of had to sit down these past couple of months and reassess everything around me. And I came to a conclusion, an epiphany, whatever it is that you want to call it, I came to a decision, ultimate decision, all right? And the ultimate decision was that I am going to have to change up the method of what I do in order to make it continue to be successful. And what I mean by that is not the fact, I'm not going to completely change, no, I'm not going to become a political analyst tomorrow. You're not going to see me talking about celebrity news and shit like that, which a lot of other YouTubers do. No, that's not what I mean. What I mean is I need to change up my formula. I can't just be the guy who plays new games from start to finish, raw, unedited footage anymore. I have to diversify myself. I have to try to find some other area where people are going to like to watch my content. To some degree, the vlogging channel, the King of Hate Vlogs, has done that. I actually have people on there. I have over 20,000 subs on that channel, and most of the people on there tell me, Phil, we don't even really watch your gameplay anymore. We primarily watch your vlogs because we like you as a person. We don't really care about the gameplay. So what I need to do is branch out and try to find other stuff. In addition, I need to do a balance, all right, a balance of gameplay and other stuff. I don't want to get rid of the gameplay. The gameplay is how I became popular. The gameplay is what made me who I am and what got me a notoriety on YouTube to begin with. But the times change, right? So I can't just keep doing what I'm doing and watch viewership go, boo, when I'm trying to live my life and run a business. So ultimately, what I want to do in the year of 2015 is I want to change the method by which I do stuff daily. Now, if you've been watching my content in 2015 so far, you've seen that I am doing things differently. What I'm doing is only one gameplay stream a day. The second half of the day I'm spending on you doing these year-end series, right? And I'll tell you, the reaction to the year-end series has been tremendously positive. The views are great. People are enjoying them. Every night people are like, Phil, when's the series coming out? Can you tell me when it's coming out? Is it coming out? Are you making a new episode? Because I really like them. And that's awesome. I think what I've really done is shown people who didn't realize that I can do this kind of stuff or maybe are just not used to it that I can really do, you know, edited stuff. It's not the best stuff. Yeah, it's still amateurish. I'm using shitty software and stuff like that. But at least it's something different. It's a breath of fresh air for me just playing a game, right? And I have all these creative ideas in my head, series that I've wanted to do for years, and I just never got to them because I was busy doing this instead of doing this and thinking and doing something creative. And I need to change that up. But what that means is that there's got to be a trade-off. So if I'm going to be spending less time playing games, less time doing gameplay videos, obviously I need to balance that with something, all right? What I need is more creative control over my time, which I've never had. For me, I'll be honest with you guys. I think most of you who've watched me for several years would agree with this statement, even though in previous years I would love to say it wasn't true. I think at this point the realization is that there's no way that I can deny it. Yes, I'm doing this for fun. Yes, this is my hobby. And I play games because I like them. But at the same time, I understand it's my job. And job performance for me is based off of views, 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 views. And I hate the fact that I have to constantly worry about views. I play a game, how are the views? What about this? How are the views? What about these views and these views over here? Did this series perform? Did that series perform? Did I make enough money to pay the bills this month? Did I do this? I hate that. I fucking hate it. It stifles my creativity. And I'll be honest with you guys. When I started doing this, all right, and it wasn't a concern because I wasn't basing my livelihood off of it, I felt a lot better doing it on a daily basis because I knew it didn't matter if I got 20 billion views or 2 views on a video I put out. I fucking didn't have to worry about it paying the bills, right? So it gave me a lot more creative control. I'll also be honest, in 2011 and even 2012, when the first couple of years when I was doing this for a living and the views were still sky high and I was making tons of money doing it, again, I had more creative control. That's what allowed me to do Project 7, right? Because I had all this, I didn't have these worries about views, and I was able to focus in on creative stuff, right? So for me, that's kind of been the problem. It's always in the back of my head. Views. Got to put out more gameplay videos today because of views and this, right? And I don't want to do that anymore. I want to be a more free to be creative and free to do the stuff that I think you guys are going to enjoy, but I need to put time into it. So really, the only thing that I need to focus on is putting out creative content for you guys that's not just raw gameplay. But the only way I can do that, the only way I can sacrifice the time is to have something to supplement that. Because let's face it, the gameplay videos get views, the views become money that pay my bills. And like I said, any other situation up to now when I lived in Connecticut, it was always like, well, not that big of a deal that I'm not making that much money or I didn't make as much money as I did last year because I'm living in Connecticut and I'm still living in this small place. Now things are different. Now I've got 2 mortgages I'm paying. I've got this debt that I've accrued to move across the country. Did I foresee a giant, sharp decline out of nowhere in the middle of last year in views because I moved? No, but it happened. And I'm not going to deny it and I'm not going to pretend like it didn't happen. It did. And now I have to make up for that. So what I'm going to do in 2015 is mix stuff up, all right? And I'm going to try to do more creative projects. Like I said, the return of Project 7. New vlog series that I haven't done before, but I've been dying to do. But to do that, I need your help. And that's why I'm adopting Patreon, all right? And you might say to yourself, what is Patreon? How does it work? I've heard that Patreon is just donations. Well, yeah, let's face it. Anything, any money you give to anyone is a donation unless you're getting a physical product or some kind of a contract to exclusive access to something. It's all donations. The Twitch sub program, right, that I was in for 1.5 years, that was technically donations. You got something out of it, so I like to talk about it and describe it as a contract between you and me, where you give me a couple bucks a month, and I give you exclusive stream chat access and emotes for the stream chat. That was the agreement that we had. Patreon's going to be more of the same, where what I want to do is give you the opportunity for as little as $1 a month to be a contributor to this, to be a patron of my creative talents and whatever you want to call the videos that I put out there. The Patreon is a play on the word patron of the arts, which means you're a fan of someone, you respect the quality or the entertainment value of what someone can put out there, and you want to financially try to help them out so that they have the freedom to do whatever they want and be more creative rather than worry about bills. That's essentially what the core of the whole program is supposed to be, all right? So Patreon, I'm going to create a Patreon page. I'm in the midst of doing it. I'm working with Patreon to get a certain page with my name on it and everything sorted out. And the way it's going to work is that I am going to, for as little as $1 a month, you can join this program. And you're going to get perks. Now, the question is, what are the perks that people would want, right? And I want you guys to understand something because I think a lot of people have misconceptions about the whole Patreon program, okay? All right. So let's talk, right? Patreon is not Kickstarter. I have to say that again because so many people have this misconception about it. Patreon is not Kickstarter. When you give someone something through Patreon, when you become a patron of someone and you give them a financial amount on a monthly basis, you're not doing that and saying, okay, well, in 6 months' time, you're going to deliver to me a product. And if you don't, now we have a legal issue because you promised me a product that you were developing and that was basically supposed to be the startup funds for that. That's not what Patreon is. Now, I'm not saying that people might not use Patreon like that, but that's not what the business is. The business model is this. You give money to the person uses that money supposedly to keep afloat, to keep doing what they're doing full time, and or supplement whatever income they have. In my case, I have income already from YouTube, it's just not as much as it used to be, and I need to stay afloat to do more creative things with you guys, right? Rather than just gameplay, which isn't cutting it anymore. So you're going to get stuff for it, but it's not, oh, I promise you in 6 months you will get this series or you will get this thing. That's not how Patreon works. That's not what people, I think people, so many people have that Kickstarter mindset. They don't understand that, all right? What it does mean is that I am very appreciative of the fact that you guys not only enjoy my content, but you want to see me continue to do new creative stuff in the future and still do gameplay in the long run. And you want to help out a little bit with my efforts to do that. And I have to worry about views all day. So what I want to do is give you back something for that. The question is, what is it that you want? And I want you guys to understand something. This underlying philosophy that I've had since day one, and I want you guys to understand this. I don't want any of my content to have some kind of a permanent paywall behind it. So what I mean by that is, just because someone's a Patreon of me, I don't want them to be the only person who can see me play a certain game. I don't want them to be the only people who can have access to something, alright? I don't think that's fair. I think that everyone, whether or not you can afford to donate to someone or not, should still get that content for free, alright? I do. As long as I can still make ad revenue on YouTube to supplement, I think that everyone should still get the content for free. Now, an idea that's been thrown around by people who I've asked about this is, why don't you time lock some footage? So, for example, I just mentioned a million times in this podcast alone about Project 7. And I said, I want to bring back Project 7, creative thing. It's going to be way different from other stuff that I've done, yada, yada, yada. So, why don't... If, for example, this is just an idea, I'm not saying that I'm doing this definitely, but this is a big idea that I'm leaning towards. If you become a Patreon of mine, okay, regardless if it's $1 a month or how much ever you pay a month, doesn't matter to me, all right? I think that everyone should be held in equal regard, and I think that if you are going to, that's another thing, if you are going to donate money to anyone, you shouldn't say, because I donated $100, I get more than the guy who donated $1. Well, no, then you missed the point. The point was you care enough about the person and you're grateful enough that they've been giving you free content for so long that you want to help them out to continue to do it, not that you're trying to get something out of it. This isn't Kickstarter, okay? So, regardless of how much that you do pay, maybe you'll get advanced access, or maybe I do episode 1 of Project 7, I release it only to Patreons, right? The Patreons get a day to look at it, and they all give me their feedback, and based off their feedback, maybe I tweak something a little bit here, maybe they noticed an audio jump or a bug here or there that I can streamline, and then I refine it, and then 2 days later, boom, now the real final edition goes public to everyone, right? That could be one thing that I do. I could do exclusive Q&A segments where if you're a Patreon, you get to submit questions to me, and it'll be like a special edition of Ask the King. Because let's face it, right now with Ask the King, you've got people doing 100 to 200, if not more, questions just on the forums. Then you've got people asking me Twitter questions. You've got questions coming in from Facebook. And a million questions all get lost in the mix. And frequently, a lot of people say, man, I asked this question 5 months in a row, and Phil never answers my damn question on Ask the King, and that's frustrating. Well, maybe I'll do a special Q&A for Patreons where you get to ask your questions, and we'll go through them. It'll be a stream chat-like atmosphere maybe or something. I don't know. Again, this is just an idea I'm throwing out there where I will try to answer your exclusive questions, all right? One thing that I would like to do and I can't do anymore, and I want to make this clear to everyone. Unfortunately, the more the research that I do, it looks like I'm not going to be able to do anything on Skype ever again. And I know that sounds bad, right? I definitely know that sounds terrible. That, oh my God, Skype, you know, you can't ever use Skype again. You used to have callers to your show. You used to even have Rambo call in and do stuff. Remember the one episode of Smark Guys that we did where Rambo called in? And they might say, well, I don't understand. Why can't you do that? It's very simple. Unfortunately, last week I was attacked by someone. I don't know who or whatever the circumstances were. I have no clue. But I was knocked off the internet a few times. Basically, DDoS attacked. So someone had gotten whiff of my IP address. And what I found out was that it was a really stupid means, right? I was using MIRC to chat, and everyone can find, apparently, your IP on MIRC, regardless of if you're hiding it or not, whatever. So fast forward, you know, to now, and I'm like, well, I have to make sure that there's other methods that people can't get my IP address, or they can DDoS attack me during a live stream or whatever. So I can't use Skype, because I actually found out Skype has huge security holes where anyone, if they just know who you are, can go on Skype and type in your name and immediately get your IP, no matter what. And someone proved this to me a couple days ago, and I was like, really? It's that easy? Yeah, it's that easy. They have that many security holes in that stupid program. And it's just like, there's nothing I can do about it. So, unfortunately, it looks like, at least in the near future, until something can be found, I can't use Skype for anything. Some people were saying, well, could you do a call-in session with Patreons and stuff like that? And the answer is, unfortunately, no. I can't go on. I can't do any Skype conversations. I can't go on a podcast. I can't do anything until I figure out another means to do it. Now, some people have suggested TeamSpeak. Other people have suggested another Ventrilo. But everyone seems to say, no, those have problems, too. Nothing is foolproof right now. So, it is what it is. I'm looking for your ideas. All right? Your ideas of what kinds of things I could provide to Patreons. And also things that obviously aren't going to piss everyone else off. Because I said this 2 years ago when I started on Twitch and I got into the subscriber program on Twitch. I would never hold it against you, the viewer. Never. That you couldn't afford to become a Patreon, or back then it was become a Twitch sub, whatever it was. That's ridiculous. The whole relationship we've had since 2008 is I make free and fun content for you, you watch it, and somehow I make out, whether it's getting internet popularity, whether it's making money since I've been with Machinima, whatever that may be. I'm not going to change my business model. That would be so screwed up for me to make a paywall, or even, like, remember a couple years ago they made subscriber-only YouTube channels and how those all fucking failed? No one pays to see a YouTube channel, but they had that. That was a big discussion. You must pay to see the YouTube channel. And everyone was like, wow, you know, are they really going to do that? No, that's not the spirit of how I became popular. Why would I change that? The spirit of how I became popular I want to retain. But I want to try to find a way to give back to those who want to help me without doing some kind of a super unfair advantage, all right? So this is the conversation I want to start tonight. Whether it's on the comments of this video, whether it's on Twitter, whether it's on the forums, which we're going to walk through later. I'm going to show you the new forums, and I'm going to show you where you can contribute and talk about these things. I need your feedback, because I need honest feedback. I want glaringly honest feedback. Now, one thing I do want to say, and I already explained this on the forums, I'm going to say it again. This is not a conversation of should Phil do Patreon. I'm doing Patreon. There's no way around not doing Patreon because I had a big decline in views on gameplay videos. If anything, if you actually look at my video content this past year, my vlog videos are up. The videos that I do on my vlogging channel actually have more views now than they did a year ago. I'm getting more viewership and better, you know, more subs and all that on that channel. It's the gameplay that's now getting played out and I need to start mixing it up. So there's no way that I'm not, you know, I have to stay afloat, to pay my bills, I have to do this. It's not something that I ever wanted to do, and that's another misconception, is that people said, well, Phil, for years, you said to people, oh, well, you know, well, how dare you, talk down to people who maybe take donations, or how maybe you possibly have issues with people who do streams and gameplay where there are donations that are involved. Because, you know, there's people who need to do that in order to stay afloat. And I understand that. I completely understand that, utterly, 100%, all right? I've been lucky. I've been the exception to the rule, guys. I really have. In a lot of ways, I've been the exception to the rule when it comes to being a YouTuber and doing this kind of stuff. I have been incredibly lucky to be able to be the kind of person where I am able to do this ongoing. I am able to do this as a job, right? And for years, all these years, since 2011 to now, I've never had a concern about money or finances or anything like that. I've been able to just consistently do what I'm doing and not worry about it, ever. It's always been like fluidity in what I'm doing. This is the first road bump that I've had, okay? And in previous years, you might have heard me say, well, people who are begging for donations or whatever, maybe they're being dishonest. And I've said things about people who are, live streaming on Twitch. Here's the bottom line. I'll tell you the honest answer because I already answered this for everyone. I think everyone kind of understands what I'm talking about if you listen to it in the right frame of reference. So let me explain. What I was saying, which people don't hear, they only hear what they want to hear, right, is that I don't support someone who's making a ridiculously great living, right, or they're able to support what they want to do ongoing on a daily basis, but then they take donations too. All right, so a perfect example, imagine if a popular pop music star, Beyonce, she's a multimillionaire, she's very successful at what she does. Oh, but by the way, now she's going to take donations, you know what I mean? Or someone who their whole point of what they do is to make money or to do donations. I am 1,000,000% against people who go on a live stream and all they literally do is they sit there and they pretend like they're there to play a game, but every 5 seconds a noise plays or a name pops up. Wow, thanks to this person who donated, and thanks to that person who donated, and thanks to this, and thanks to that. And you know what I mean? It's just ridiculous. It's that, for me, if I'm going to do gameplay footage for you guys, I want it to be unadulterated, I want it to be real, and I want it to be not some kind of hyper-edited, faked stuff, staged stuff, or stuff that's constantly interrupted every few seconds, right? So that it becomes just a donation drive. And really, it disgusted me being on Twitch, where I knew this was a website where there were people daily, I'm not talking a couple people, hundreds of people, if not more, who made their entire living doing e-begging. The whole point of their stream was to sit there and say, please donate, please do my Patreon, please send me money. And every 5 seconds, there's noises about people sending the money, money, money. That's not what my content is about, and I want you guys to understand that even though I am adopting Patreon, that's not what this is going to become. This is not going to become an issue where I'm basically going to be doing things such as just, wow, we're just going to be talking about money, 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 money nonstop, right? No. And yeah, from time to time, once this is in effect, you will hear me mentioning Patreon, but it's not going to be, wow, Patreon, Patreon, every time, Patreon, 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 Patreon. No. How often have you ever, in the years that I've ever done content on YouTube, have you ever heard me say, please subscribe, please thumbs up this video, please donate money? How often have you ever heard me say that? Right? I don't want me to change and become like that. I know there are people that's all they're about. That's not really what I want that to be about, okay? So even though I will be, accepting stuff and I will be talking about Patreon from time to time, I don't want you guys to think that my content's going to completely change. Now, some people have completely lied, all right? And I know that there are, the second that I even mentioned doing Patreon ever, people completely lied and said, but Phil said that he would never accept donations. And he's completely dishonest of him. It's completely, counterproductive to what he used to say. And it's completely hypocritical for him to do Patreon, all right? Wrong. Because people love to put words in my mouth rather than actually listen to the message that I'm saying. Or they take one instance of when I said something as the overall Bible truth of everything rather than listening to what I'm saying, all right? If I were able to continue to make a living the way that I've been doing for the past several years and not have any issue paying all the bills and not have any issue, having to worry about views, and if people's, if I was able to do that and people were okay with just gameplay, which obviously they're not anymore, I would continue going on the way that I've been doing since day one. It's not that situation anymore. Reality has changed. The world has changed. It's a completely different kind of gameplay world out there, quite honestly. It really is. It's different. It's a different atmosphere on YouTube. There's way more competition. There's way more going on. It's not back when I started, and I completely understand that, all right? In 2011, when I started making money with Machinima, and it was a lot of money, and I was like, wow, it makes sense that I'm making a lot of money doing this. Why would I accept donations? I closed off my PayPal donation link completely, 100%. I closed it off, and I said, I will not accept donations anymore because I'm making so much money at this point that there's no way that I would accept them, right? It doesn't make sense to me. It would be immoral. Again, it would be like Beyonce, and in no way was I making Beyonce numbers, but I was making some pretty decent money and saying, oh, I'm going to now take donations when I'm making a good living as well would be dishonest, all right? I have not accepted a single monetary donation since that time. So here we are, fast forward 4 years later, we're now finally in a situation that's a little bit different, all right? And now, okay, I need your help if you want to see me continue to do what I do on a daily basis and even mix it up and do more creative stuff for you. It's a different situation. It's not black and white. People love to say the world is black and white. It's all about black and white, right? It's either you do or you don't. No, it's never been like that. And people, once you grow up and you get more mature, you start to understand that. You realize, oh man, the world is not black and white. There's many, many variable shades of gray. And some people will basically, excuse me, some people will say, okay, that's all right. That's acceptable, because we understand because we're humans. And other people, they will only see this black and white, right? Am I 100% against people taking donations? No. Am I against people making their entire reason for putting out a stream or doing content getting money? Yes. Am I 100% against people who are making tons of money, asking for more, basically double dipping? Yes, I'm against that. This is not the situation for me right now. I've seen people say, well, Phil, so what you're basically saying is you want more money to do the same thing you've done all these years. No. I just said, I don't want to continue to just do gameplay. I want to be in a situation where I can be more creative and do better things for you guys. Do more edited videos. If anything, the year-end videos that I've put out so far have gotten tremendous positive response. The problem is, I can't focus in and put that much time into doing those kind of videos because I'm so busy worrying about money, 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 views, views, views. Right? And I need to remedy that somehow. All right. So anyway, that is the deal with Patreon. Now, the good news is very soon I will actually have an update for you in regards to this. The Patreon will be launched, okay? And we'll have a lot more information about it to talk about and everything going on. At this point, it's just the preliminary stages. I am talking with Patreon. We're getting a page set up and everything. And when this does happen, you'll hear me talk about it a little bit more. Excuse me. And I'll give you more details. Again, I need your feedback, guys. I need your feedback in regards to this. Because if I don't get your feedback, I can't actually give you what you want. And I don't know what people would actually want that's reasonable for a Patreon of my work. At the same time, I don't want to do things that other people who can't afford to be a Patreon would be offended at. So we need to find the happy medium. And that's what we're going to be working on together these next few weeks. All right. I still got a lot to talk about in regards to wrestling and the website, but my voice already, I can feel, it's feeling hoarse. I just talked for an hour straight. So what I think I'm going to do here is I'm going to take a short break. During that break, I'm going to relax my voice, probably get another drink or whatever. We're going to come back. We're going to talk about my thoughts about pro wrestling, and then we're going to do a quick walkthrough of the new website and the forums, and we're going to really get into that, okay? So don't go anywhere. If you're watching this live on stream, just stick around. There's going to be a commercial break. Well, actually, it won't even be a commercial break. I don't even run commercials anymore because I stream on YouTube. But anyway, don't go anywhere. I'm going to just, go away for a few minutes. I'll come right back. For those of you watching on YouTube, I actually going to put a timestamp in the description of the video so you can just go right to that timestamp and you can jump ahead and you don't have to wait during this commercial break, all right? So thanks, everyone, for watching. I'll be right back with more Hate Live. Stick around. All right, everyone, welcome back to the Hate Live podcast, second half here, although I hope that I don't go too long. We're going to be talking some wrestling news, some funny stuff about wrestling that I want to reveal to you, which is kind of funny, and then I'm going to go ahead and do a quick website walkthrough of the new site. Now, I just want to say this, if you're watching this live on stream, I apologize, the stream did crash. A lot of people speculating what it was. I'll be honest with you. I think I got attacked again. I think it was a DDoS attack. It's exactly the same symptoms that I had the previous times that I've been attacked, which I've been two other times. And I don't know what to say. I'm not getting contacted by anyone about why it's happening. If someone's doing it, they're probably doing it just to be malicious and see a stream crash that a lot of people were watching. It is what it is. I can't control it. I can't help it. If the stream goes down again, I apologize. I strongly recommend to you guys that you do watch the podcast on the King of Hate vlogs later tonight when it does go live in its entirety on demand rather than worrying about the stream crash again. If it does, I apologize. All right. So, that's all I'm going to say. Let's continue on. All right. So, let's go ahead and let's talk about wrestling. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. A topic that I have not talked about in quite a long time, okay? Because a few weeks ago I talked about it, the whole CM Punk thing that was revealed in December. CM Punk went on a podcast and said all his honest feelings about the WWE or whatever. But the thing is, I don't have my wrestling commentary show anymore, Smark Guys. I don't. It's gone, all right? And the reason it's gone is because it used to be a co-op show that I did this co-op commentary about pro wrestling with my friend John Rambo. And John Rambo has opted out of doing any kind of YouTube content outside of the things that he does on his own channel, which is perfectly fine. So I basically put the series on hiatus since I moved in the summer, and there has not been a new episode since then, all right? And a lot of people have been contacting me on a weekly basis when things like Raw go, and they say, Phil, did you see Raw? I really like to hear your take on this. It sucks that your wrestling commentary show is gone. What's happening with that? Yada, yada, yada. Now, I even said earlier in the show itself that unfortunately, I can't use Skype to do anything anymore. Because after being DDoS attacked, it's obvious people know these different ways to get my IP. So I can't, that's a glaring hole. If I was on Skype immediately, someone could get it and attack me. So I can't use Skype. So I can't even do a co-op commentary show about wrestling anymore. Whatever I do, quite literally would have to be like in person, right? So that means no, I can't even have like a special guest call in or anything. It's just going to have to be me talking. And I've been debating either doing an entire show of just me talking about wrestling commentary, and by the way, it would probably would not be weekly, it would probably be a bi-weekly show, so maybe twice a month I would do this show, and it would just be me talking about all the stuff that I saw in WWE and possibly TNA, now that TNA is supposedly coming back to this new television station, Destination America, which incidentally I actually have. I didn't even know I had it, and then the other day I was looking at my channels, holy shit, I have it. I never even fucking heard of this channel, but I actually have it. Alright, so I was thinking, I need to talk about wrestling. Should I bring back the show and do a solo show by myself maybe every 2 weeks? Or what we could do is exactly what we're about to do now, I could make it an ongoing segment on Hate Live where I talk a little bit, I'm not going to go too much into detail, but a little bit into the detail about what wrestling is going through and what WWE is doing and give you my opinions on it. So I'd like to hear your opinion on that. If you guys could let me know, would you like to see a dedicated segment on Hate Live, or would you like to see me actually do the podcast, the wrestling commentary show solo? Let me know, whether in the comments of this video, on Twitter, on the forums, which we're going to walk through shortly, however it happens, go ahead and please let me know, okay? So anyway, let's talk about wrestling and what's been going on. Recently in pro wrestling, well, since Survivor Series, when John Cena's team ended up winning Survivor Series, remember it was Team Cena versus Team Authority, and whoever Survivor Series team won this event would basically take control of the company. Well, incidentally, because of an amazing run by Dolph Ziggler, John Cena's team wins and the Authority gets banned from WWE, and the stipulation is given by Mr. McMahon that if the Authority is ever to be reinstated, they have to be reinstated by John Cena. So, that being said, here we are, fast forward to a month later, right? Actually, not even a month later after Survivor Series, right? And quite honestly, a lot of the stuff that's been going on in WWE has been filler. Big Show sided with the Authority and turned on his team, but now he had nothing to really do because the Authority's gone, so he's kind of floundering. Eric Rowan's floundering. Luke Harper drops the Intercontinental title back to Dolph Ziggler at the pay-per-view. Now he's floundering. What the hell's he supposed to be doing? And a lot of these people for the past month have kind of just been blobbering around, not really doing much of anything, because quite honestly, WWE is probably trying to figure out, gee, how do we build to the Royal Rumble and then to WrestleMania, and they don't want to do too much major stuff now. They want to wait and save it for the January to the WrestleMania build at the Road to WrestleMania, they call it every year. So, excuse me. So that being said, the past month has been pretty much filler content. And really, every once in a while, there's a good match, but I don't really think that anything's been standout or anything like that. So not this past Raw from this week, but last week's Raw. One of the worst Raws I've seen. You got a night that has some good wrestling and some not. Edge and Christian come back as the guest hosts. And by the way, it's announced during the course of the show, which no one even knew, Christian is retired. What? Christian has retired from in-ring work. It's officially announced during the show, of all people by Paul Heyman, that Christian has had one too many concussions and the doctors have ruled that he should not wrestle anymore. Christian is officially retired from ring work. And apparently this is official. Like, if you search online, it's like, oh no, that actually was not, like, a plot. Like, yeah, Christian's done with in-ring work. They just never really had a retirement ceremony for Christian. To which I say, so Edge retires and he gets this big, to-do. He gets inducted into the Hall of Fame. Christian retires and basically doesn't even get a fucking bag of cheese poofs. He's just, whatever. He's off TV, right? Great. So anyway, that being said, Edge and Christian are the host of Raw this week, and they're terrible. Like, it's stupid. Some of the segments actually aren't very good. Some of the segments actually are kind of, like, not very good at all. Christian is basically being made to be kind of the heel here. Like, Edge will be doing something really cool and hip, and then Christian comes in, makes Christian look bad. I don't know what they're doing. But the culmination of the show, all right, after this not even a month, has the Authority been off TV. Seth Rollins, even though he still has the Money in the Bank briefcase, and he still has J&J security, even though the question is who's paying them if the Authority isn't there anymore, it doesn't really make any sense. They really have nothing to do, and they're all floundering around. So basically, WWE writers realize we wrote our way out of the Authority plot line, okay, which is Triple H and Stephanie being in power. But now we don't know what to do with it, so we're going to write ourselves back into the situation because that's all we need to know. That's all we know how to do, the same thing over and over. I mean, traditionally, WWE just does the same fucking thing over and over. It's very rare when they have something original that they don't completely ruin. Like, for example, the Nexus or something like that, that within a few weeks is complete trash. So in typical WWE fashion, we have to find a way for the Authority to come back because we don't know how else to do anything because we're fucking one-trick ponies. So this week on Raw, or I'm sorry, the 2 weeks ago on Raw, Edge and Christian were the host. At the end of the show, they decided to have the Cutting Edge Peep Show, where it's going to be Edge and Christian doing a talk show with multiple people from the WWE, and one of the guests that they have is Seth Rollins. Seth Rollins comes out, basically talks some nonsense, whatever, calls John Cena to come out, right? And John Cena never shows up, but basically John Cena disrespects Seth Rollins or whatever. So Seth Rollins smashes Christian in the head with the briefcase. I'm sorry, not in the head. Let me take that back because they're selling that he has concussion issues. Hits him in the stomach with the briefcase. Christian rolls out of the ring and is gone for the next 20 minutes. I kid you not. He goes like this, boom. Like, imagine if someone just punched you in the stomach and you're out for 20 minutes. Like, he must have, like, a glass stomach or something. So Christian's out of the ring. Edge is in the ring. They knock him down. They put him down, and they're going to crush his neck. John Cena, if you don't come out right now, we will break Edge's neck. So, of course, John Cena comes out being the goody-goody hero he is. And he comes out and he says, no, don't do it. Well, the only thing I'm going to do, the only reason I won't break Edge's neck here in the ring is if you bring the Authority back. Now, I want us to think logically about this. And I know it's very, very stupid for us to think logically about wrestling because wrestling isn't logical. They continuously forget plot lines and things that happened in the past and they have to suspend your disbelief. But this is just beyond stupid. Oh, WWE Hall of Famer is in the ring. Someone is threatening to break his neck and either cripple or kill him. No one comes out but John Cena. No cops, no security guards, no WWE management who would probably get sued into oblivion. No one comes out but John Cena. Only he comes out. And then he says, okay, I bring back the Authority. And then just to add insult to injury, Seth Rollins says, well, I'm going to kill him anyway. I'm going to kill him anyway. He says he's going to kill someone on G-rated WWE. And then he goes to curb stomp Edge. And of course, John Cena stops it, right? John Cena stops the fight or whatever. They beat up John Cena. Oh, the authority's coming back. And then, of course, then Triple H and Stephanie walk out. And there you have it. The authority's back. So I said at this point, at the end of that Monday Night Raw, I tweeted. And I said, this is probably the worst ending to Raw you could possibly have ever at the end of a year. And I said, let's rewind back several years. I said, let's rewind way back to the end. I believe it was the end of 2012. Don't quote me on that, but I remember the very last Raw of 1 year goes off the air. CM Punk, the WWE champion, Daniel Bryan, the World Heavyweight Champion, or it could have been vice versa. Don't quote me on that. It's one or the other. And Zack Ryder, I think it was either the U.S. or the Intercontinental, one of those champions, right? Three faces, people, they're white hot people, love these guys, the top of the company, all the champions. They go off the air, one of the hottest endings of the year you could ever see on WWE programming. Within 3 weeks, WWE completely fucks it up, okay? Completely fucks it up and says, we don't want that anymore. Made everyone drop their titles. Zack Ryder's neck supposedly got broken, loses his title. Daniel Bryan, in the quickest squash match ever at WrestleMania, loses his title. So let's just undo everything that's great because this is what the fans wanted, right? So, here you go, right? Fast forward a week later from this ridiculously bad ending of Raw, and I said, listen, they've done good endings to Raw before to start a new year. At the end of that year, when you had the three champions that were all the faces of the company, you wanted to come back that next week and say, wow, where are they going to go with this? Because this is great. They very rarely have this happen. And it was a real feel-good moment ending to the year. This year, they say, let's completely ruin everything. We had all this feel-good stuff. We overcame the authority at Survivor Series. Let's completely erase it all and have the most horrendous ending possible to Raw for the year. With the authority come out celebrating, all the heels are on the ramp of everything. Brock fucking Lesnar comes out and celebrates with the authority. What? Brock Lesnar, who was attacking Triple H and his family, had the match that supposedly retired Triple H years ago. Brock Lesnar comes out and celebrates with the authority on the ramp. And it's like the worst fucking downer that anyone could ever have at the end of a year. Okay? So this I said this last week. I said, that's the worst ending to Raw I think I've seen in quite some time. And people disagree. No, Phil. It's good. You just watch next week. This is great because now the authority's back. Now we have conflict. And I said, no, you don't understand. WWE doesn't know how to do good writing. So next week's show is going to be all crap. It's going to be all the heels shitting on the faces. The authority will be completely in control and no one will be able to do anything about it. No, 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 no. No, it's going to be good. The faces will come and stand against the authority. So guess what Monday Night Raw was this past week? Every person who is on the Survivor Series team against Team Authority gets completely squashed in an unfair, one-sided match. The matches were quick, shitty, or rigged so that the faces couldn't win. Basically, completely disrespecting the viewer, saying, there's no reason for you to watch this episode. Because if you actually watch this episode, you'll see that anything that we're going to say that's legit is worthless. So, oh, wow, there's going to be a great match between Dolph Ziggler and Wade Barrett. Oops, Dolph Ziggler rolls up Wade Barrett in 3 seconds. Barrett's pissed, beats the shit out of Ziggler. Oh, now it's a two out of three falls match, and of course, Barrett wins. What? So that match is a throwaway. Oh, Eric Rowan against Luke Harper. This could be good. The former members of the Wyatt family. Let's see them square off. Oh, but the special guest referees are J&J Security, who interfere massively, and the match ends in like 3 minutes, a cheating win by Luke Harper. What? So why would I want to watch Raw, right? You ended the year on a low note. You started the year on a low note. There's no desire for me to watch the show anymore. Like, I don't care. I don't care that every week you're going to have the faces get squashed. I hate the authority because we're supposed to. You made us hate them. There's no sense or any kind of an inkling that anyone's ever going to overcome the authority. And even if you do overcome the authority, within a month they find a way to come back anyway. So why don't you just quit the fucking company? It almost seems to me what they're saying is, if you don't want to deal with Triple H and Stephanie and Vince's bullshit, quit WWE. Okay, well then I just won't watch it anymore. Seriously, just don't watch it anymore. Turn off the TV and never watch WWE again. So, quite honestly, what is the point of watching WWE television right now? In fact, you shouldn't. You actually literally should not watch WWE television until the Royal Rumble, because at the Royal Rumble, we've got some returns. Keep in mind, we've got Daniel Bryan coming back to return to the Royal Rumble. More than likely, Sting's going to appear at the Royal Rumble and may even be a mystery entrant in the Royal Rumble. So there's going to be all these mystery elements happening at the Royal Rumble, and undoubtedly, that'll lead up to stuff going on at WrestleMania. Why the fuck would I watch it now, when all I know it's going to be is filler, faces stomp the shit out of, or get the shit stomped out of them by the heels, Triple H and Stephanie gloating that they're so powerful because they think it's a character. I'm sorry, Triple H and Stephanie, it's not a character. You guys can't fucking keep yourselves off the show and let your talent sell the show. Instead, you are so egomaniacal, you need to be on the show every week. We don't fucking want you on the show. No one does. You're not good heels anymore because all you do is hog the whole fucking show when you're in 14 separate fucking segments. We want to see wrestlers. We want to see the new talent. We don't want to see you motherfucking old people anymore. Stay the fuck off the show. But they don't listen. They will continuously come back. They will continuously, you know, just keep doing this bullshit every week. And it really pisses me the fuck off because when they've done, in my opinion, this past year has been a filler year. And I know the second half of the year, I didn't do Smart Guys, so you guys don't even know my opinion. This year's been a filler year where a lot of the guys that they wanted to push or be the top guys in the company have been injured or out. CM Punk quit. Daniel Bryan's been injured. Roman Reigns got injured twice. And then there's other people who could, Randy Orton keep getting injured. People keep getting injured. And when they get injured, you can't have a consistent program. So they've been floundering. Oh, we have to get Dean Ambrose up and then squash him. We have to get Bray Wyatt up there, then squash him, then break up his group, but now bring him back up and push him. They'll probably squash him and get a Royal Rumble, then bring him up. It doesn't make any sense. There, at least what I can say is this. At least when you turn on WWE now, you can see fresh faces. You can see The Shield all now doing independent stuff. You can see other people who are up-and-comers who are getting pushes. The problem is, you also see Triple H and Stephanie who don't fucking belong there, all right? They just stay the fuck in the back room and pretend like they aren't part of the company anymore because no one cares about them, and all they do is waste the time that other people could be getting pushed, all right? So, I'm pretty angry right now at WWE because they had this great thing going. Okay, the Authority, the culmination of the plotline at Survivor Series, and then within a month they undo it, and now it's the same plotline again. It's probably the same plotline till WrestleMania when finally Sting will probably have a match with Triple H or something like that, and that'll undo it for a while, and then he'll come back again. So, whatever. It's the same rigmarole with WWE. It pisses me the fuck off, and I hope that you guys, you know, if you can even bear with it, I don't know. I'm going to try to watch it weekly, but we'll see what happens. And I hope you'll give me my feedback, whether you want to hear me talk about this more on Hate Live when I do Hate Live, or would you rather hear me do it in its own show every other week or something like that, okay? All right, now, a few more topics. In fact, we're running out of time, guys. So, unfortunately, I wanted to talk about the United States financial system. It doesn't look like it's going to happen right now on this show. Maybe I'll save that for next time because right now I'm running out of time. I want to show you one really funny thing in regards to WWE, and then I want to give you a quick walkthrough of the new website. So what I'm going to do is something I rarely do. I'm actually going to move the camera. Well, I'm not even moving the camera. I'm moving the microphone. We're going to go over to my PC. On my PC, I'm going to show you guys some funny stuff, and then we're going to show you the website, and I'm going to walk you through all the new stuff with the website, okay? So let's go ahead. I'm going to grab the mic and take it with me. Sit over here. All right. Here we go, everybody. Hold on as I move across my office. And you get a nice view of my pillows there. I'm sure you're thrilled. All right, so the first thing I want to show you guys here, I'll do this so that you're not staring at nothing. Where's the other thing? Here we go. So the first thing I want to show you guys is that there's a new game coming out next week. This game is, once again, it's a mobile game, and I know you guys, Phil's playing mobile games, right? It's something that looked interesting to me because it's actually from the same people who made, of all things, Injustice for mobile devices. Now, if you don't know what I'm talking about, yeah, if you remember, I played the fighting game Injustice, right? I played Injustice a couple years ago, and, you know, this game was a fighting game made by Netherrealm, the same people who made Mortal Kombat. And this game featured DC heroes in Mortal Kombat-like fighting situations. They almost looked like Mortal Kombat characters, right? And And basically, it was pretty good. It actually ended up being quite good. Oof, when you actually, you know, played it, it was like a combination of Mortal Kombat and a few other things, and I actually liked it. So there was a mobile version of the game, okay, that actually ended up being a almost, it wasn't a port, it didn't even play like the fighting game itself, alright? It played more like a mobile, you tap the screen to punch, you swipe your finger to do heavier punches, you build up supers, you tap the screen to do a super move or whatever, and it was like 3-on-3 combat. And you would get characters, you would level them up, you would buy credits to level them up even more, buy items to put on these characters. And for those of you who didn't see the Injustice mobile game, it was quite good. Now, at this point, the mobile game is almost 2 years old, it's very outdated at this point, and very few people are playing it. So, guess what happened? Netherrealm, because they did so well, it actually was reported, if you can believe this, it was actually reported that This Injustice mobile game was doing better in the long run than the actual console fighting game. The mobile version of the game did better than the console version, the mainstream retail game. It actually made more money. As silly as that sounds, apparently it was true, okay? And a lot of people were blown away by that, saying things, oh, really? So a mobile game did better than the console version. That's like a first. It's actually, the truth of the matter is, it's happening more and more in this day and age, and people just don't really want to admit it, that mobile gaming is becoming such a freaking huge market that it's actually making more money because it's repeated transactions. You know, retail game, you spend $60, you have the game, you have all the characters for the game, you play it, and that's it. A mobile game, it's free. But then, after you play it for a few hours, oh, you want the next level of the character, you gotta unlock credits to play or buy this character, and people get hooked and addicted, and they put money into these games, and they end up making way more money than the actual regular console versions of the games. Okay? So, what I want to show you guys is the newest game, ladies and gentlemen. The newest game coming from Netherrealm Studios. Again, the same people who made Injustice. They have made a game. They have teamed with WWE to make a video game. Okay? The video game is called Immortals. You may say, what is that? I don't understand. Well, you're about to understand. Wait till I just show you what you're about to see. You're going to say, what the flip am I looking at? Hold on. Ladies and gentlemen, this is ridiculous. This is John Cena in Immortals. So you may say to yourself, oh yeah, they call John Cena Super Cena, right? They joke that he's like Superman, he's unbeatable. In Immortals, he is Superman. He actually has the stupid hustle, loyalty, and respect symbol on his chest where the Superman S would be. He looks like Superman. And I almost guarantee you, he's gonna be like Superman. Because it's made by Netherrealm. So what they probably did, they probably reskinned the Injustice app game to be a new game and called it Immortals. Alright, here, I'm going to go through some pictures for you. Here's the logo. What the fuck? On the left, sorry, it's not centered here. I wonder if I can fix that. Hold on. Hold on, here, I'll do a new screen region. Oh my god. This is just something else. Oh my, look at this. On the left, you've got The Big Show. And on the right, you've got Roman Reigns. Yes, The Big Show, who's been buffed up to be this giant barbarian-looking motherfucker. And on the right, you've got Roman Reigns with a stupid, like, stretched-out goatee ponytail kind of a deal. All right, let's keep going. Hold on, there's more pictures. All right, so what you got here, if you can't tell, on the left there is John Cena looking like Superman. In the middle, I think that's supposed to be Brock Lesnar, who appears to be like some kind of a magma-powered dude. And on the right, you've got The Rock. I mean, it's undoubted from his tattoo there, right? You can tell his tattoo, you know, that's definitely him. That's all we got here. Hold on. I know there's another picture of Nikki Bella, too. I gotta see if I can find it. Hold on a second here. Bella Twins Immortals. I've seen this. And there's one of Sheamus. Ah, here it is. Look at this. So here's the Bella Twins. These are supposed to be the Bella Twins. They look more like G. Looks kind of like Kitana. And maybe another one of those generic ninjas from Mortal Kombat? Yeah, but supposed to be Nikki and Brie Bella, even though it looks absolutely nothing like them whatsoever. Oh, here's the other picture. Hold on, let me keep going here. That's not it. Here we go. Here's Sheamus. Sheamus with three different ponytail beards. This is going to be... If it's not... Oh, wait, there's more? Oh, wait a minute. Triple H. Yes, the Conqueror Triple H, who doesn't look any different than he did when he wore that stupid He-Man looking shit at one of those WrestleManias when he went up against John Cena. And then, of course, the final character, it's the girl from the Lego movie. She's the final character. No, that's just another picture that somehow is in this weird slideshow. But, yeah, pretty weird game, huh? And so, just so you guys understand, this game launches supposedly next week. I've seen conflicting dates. I've seen some things say it's launching on the 13th of January, and I've seen other things saying it's launching on the 15th of January. So whatever one it launches, it's supposedly a mobile game. I think it's going to be free. If it's any kind of an indication from what... And by the way, this is just the website. I'm going to go back here for a second. If it's any indication from... the way that the Injustice game worked, it'll probably be a free download. You can probably play it, you know, for a while for free, and then you either have to buy credits to continuously play it more, or to unlock or buy the higher versions of the characters or weapons and or armor for them to make them better. And that's how the game works. That's how they're going to microtransaction you into the fucking bankruptcy. So I'll probably be checking it out. I don't know if I'll be talking about it or reviewing it. But I just thought it was hilarious when I saw this online. I was like, you've got to be joking me. Like, this is real. And yeah, it's real. Netherrealm basically said, well, we don't want to make a mortal version of mortal version. We don't want to make a mobile version of Mortal Kombat because people probably wouldn't like it. So we're going to do it with WWE instead. Oh, my goodness. All right. So the last thing I want to do today, everyone, I want to do a walkthrough of the website for you guys. And what I'm going to do now is jump over, as you can see here. This is now a screen capture of thekingofhate.com. And what I'd like to do is very briefly do a guided walkthrough for you of the new website to explain to you the features, to explain to you exactly how it works, so that you don't have to worry about knowing what is Phil going to be doing on a daily basis, where do I post up suggestions, where do I post up, questions, where do I do this and that. We're going to show you everything right here. This is thekingofhate.com. Not www.thekingofhate.com, it's just thekingofhate.com. This is the homepage. What I've done at the top of here, what you can see is a scrolling picture that basically is going to go through all of my latest, greatest, and ongoing game playthroughs for you so that you can see actively what I'm working on, all right? So you can see here's a picture. It's a whole new twist on the best games of 2013 in Grand Theft Auto 5, the first-person shooter on PS4. Watch it now. You click there, it'll open up the playlist for you right away. And as you can see, I've added the latest thing. The year-end series are there. The latest things that I've done are all there. And I'm actually going to add tonight, because I forgot to yesterday, the worst gaming trends. I'm also going to add there, so that's kind of in the rotation. All right? So what's Phil been up to lately? You want to know? You just go right here, and you'll find out. Right here in the stream section, if I am live streaming, this will have this statement that says, watch the stream live now. If not, I believe it just says offline or no stream, or it won't even show up. Okay? Below that, you see the schedule. The schedule is there to tell you exactly what I'm going to be doing next. And it should cater to your time zone. So whatever time zone you live in, this schedule should automatically adjust to your time zone. So this was a big problem with my old website. I would type in, oh, I'm going to be doing this stream Eastern time. This video will go live at 5 p.m. Eastern time. People were like, well, what's Eastern time? I live in Europe or I live in Asia. You know, I live in a small island in the Galapagos and I don't even know what time zone I'm in. So how do I know what time Phil's going to be doing stuff? This section is supposed to auto-adjust to your time zone. So regardless of where you live in the world, you don't even need to know that anymore. You just go here, and like as you can see, here's today's schedule. Well, the Dragon Age Inquisition live stream already happened, So it grayed out. If it were happening now, it would actually be not grayed out. Okay. And then here, the Hate Live podcast stream. What I've done is I put a time on there, 9:30 p.m., but I screwed it up, and that's my fault. I actually put the wrong time on there. I was supposed to put 6:30 p.m., my local time, and I put 9:30. I goofed. I goofed it up, okay? I did the same thing here. This I did on purpose because I know that when I upload Hate Live, it takes so damn long to go live on YouTube, right, that I actually put a super late time there. So basically what's going to happen is on a daily basis when it hits midnight, whatever midnight is your time, it's going to show you the upcoming events. And if one has not happened yet, it'll be shown in white. If it already happened that day, it shows in gray. It even has this convenient thing here that tells you the current time and then what's the next scheduled live event. So as you can see, I screwed up. And it says the podcast should be next, even though we're already live streaming. That's my fault. Down here, we've got the Twitter feed. So a lot of people have expressed the opinion to me that I hate Twitter. I don't want to use Twitter. I can't imagine in this day and age people who don't want to use Twitter. I could see like 2-3 years ago, but now it seems like almost everyone on the planet Earth is using Twitter, or at least watching other people use it. So my Twitter is at @theycallmeDSP, but if for whatever reason you don't want to follow me on Twitter, but you still want to know what I'm talking about and what I'm up to, this is a live feed on the website. This will update whenever I tweet, and you can see you can even follow me here, and you can tweet me straight from here if you have a Twitter account, okay? Recently played is going to automatically bring up my most recently added playlists to my YouTube channel. So whatever the newest projects are I'm working on are going to be shown here. All right. Now, the cool thing about this website, it doesn't only work on desktops. This website auto-adjusts itself to fit on mobile devices. I know because I've used this website both on my iPad and on my Both on my iPad and my iPhone, and it displays properly. So that's a huge improvement over the other website. It always would not distort. It wouldn't fit. You couldn't read it. This one works on everything, okay? That's only one feature. If you go to stream, click on stream. If I am live streaming, this is going to show you. Look, it's a stream within a stream. It's fucking streamception right now, ladies and gentlemen. We're watching a stream within a stream, okay? Then down here, you've got the stream chat, which we just recently fixed. We were having problems with it, so we did a different client, and now it works. So you can now chat here live during the streams, okay? If a stream is not live streaming, this tab will not even show up. So you can't accidentally click here thinking there's a stream going on. There's nothing going on. Oh, streamception all over again. All right, if you go to the playlists tab, this is the search functionality of the website. You can use this now to find anything I've ever done, ever. Okay? So what happens is when you go here, it'll show you the most recent playlist. But let's say, for example, I wanted to see Dan Madness. How many times in Street Fighter 4 have I played with Dan? Let's search for Dan Madness. Well, we've got Street Fighter 4 HD Dan Madness from 2009. So that's the original Street Fighter 4. And then we've got Ultra Street Fighter 4 Dan Madness. So there were two different times while I played Street Fighter 4 that I did Dan Madness, okay? Now, of course, as you can see, that's from Darkside Phil and DSP Gaming. I don't believe we've added DSP Street Fighter on here yet. And just to double check that, if I search for Mortal Kombat, yeah. As you can see, it did not add some of the channels. So right now, this is live. You can search for anything that was ever on Darkside Phil or on DSP Gaming, both of my YouTube gaming channel. So let's say I'm trying to think of an obscure playthrough. You know what? That's a good one. Let's look for obscure. That was a playthrough I did. There it is. Obscure co-op playthrough from late 2013. There it is right there. What else? What's another playthrough that's like a really, oh, really not well-known one that you may want to find? I'm trying to think of something from the original channel. What was the name of that game? Oh, there's a game with time travel mechanics, and I can't remember what the hell it was now. How about this? Wolfenstein. That's right. If you remember, I've played two Wolfenstein games over the years. I played Wolfenstein, which came out in 2009. It was supposed to be the series reboot. And then I recently played Wolfenstein The New Order earlier in 2014. So both of those come up. A lot of people always say, oh, the best playthrough Phil ever did was Heavy Rain. Well, just by typing in Heavy Rain, you get the original playthrough on Darkside Phil. You get the alternate choices gameplay from Darkside Phil. You get the Heavy Rain DLC, the Taxidermist from Darkside Phil with special co-op commentator John Rambo. And then over on DSP Gaming, you get the Heavy Rain PlayStation Move demo that I did with the PlayStation Move controls. So you get all that just by searching. Now, I want you guys to understand, eventually we're going to add everything. We're going to add DSP Street Fighter. We're going to add the King of Hate HD, which was my old vlogging channel. We're going to add the King of Hate Vlogs, which is my current... I'm sorry, the King of Hate... Yeah, the King of Hate Vlogs, my current vlogging channel. We're going to add Red Dead DSP. We're going to add everything. Everything will be added. But right now, it's just Darkside Phil and DSP Gaming. But this is a tremendous resource, and here's why. So many people, over the past several years, since early 2013, have contacted me and said, Phil, were you aware that on YouTube, if you try to search anything for your stuff, it doesn't come up? What you either get is something completely unrelated, someone else doing what you search for. So you may type in, Darkside Phil Heavy Rain, and instead you get someone else playing Heavy Rain. Or you get a bunch of hater videos about me. Because YouTube completely changed their search algorithms in early 2013, making YouTube search completely fucking useless. So you don't have to use YouTube search anymore when it comes to my content. You can actually do it all straight from this page. Okay? And again, like I said, eventually, outside of gameplay, we're going to add everything else, but that's going to take a little bit of time. All right? If you click on the series tab, it'll bring up all of my ongoing vlogging series where you can watch either the latest episodes or you can talk about it on the forums if you click there, right? And it tells you, you know, where you can find it and what the latest episode was, okay? Now let's do the forums because this is, I was not able to do last time that we did a look at my site. Let's click on forums. This is the new kingofhate.com forums. I'm the first to admit, yes, it looks bare bones, all right? It looks absolutely bare bones. It doesn't look like anything amazing. It's very basic. We didn't do anything visually to make it spruced up. What we wanted to do was get a website up for you guys that was functional. That was really the focus of doing this, was getting the website up and running and functional. I just want you guys to know, you're probably already looking at some of the tacos. The mobs are asleep once more. This is post blue food and post sharks. It's just silly threads. They don't actually violate any forum rules. It's just people being silly. This is dumb. Phil's plummeting popularity. All you need to do is read it. And it's actually not about that. It's about basically people giving suggestions on, you know, how can I improve my content? Things that maybe turn people off to me. It's actually a constructive thread, but I told the guy who made the thread, I said, why'd you name it that? Like, it's a misnomer. Maybe, of course, I think the reason he did it is he was trying to get extra views on his thread, trying to cause drama. But anyways, you can see, we've got 534 members since the website launched just a little bit more than a week ago. What I want to do is show you some of the sections of the forums, so you guys know where exactly you can go. First of all, there's a multimedia section that takes care of all of your needs, including anime and manga, movies and TV, music. People are talking about books and comic books. And there's going to be a lot more stuff added shortly as people suggest different sections. In the gaming section, we've got it broken down by PC and consoles. If you go into those, they'll be more broken down. And here, look, all these threads about different games, Kingdom Hearts 3 speculation, all kinds of stuff going on. Here, your game of the year for 2014. A bunch of people are talking about what are their personal picks for the game of the year. So you can see there's all kinds of discussion on this forum outside of my content. And I want people to understand that. That it's not just talking about my content. Now, you want to talk about specifically my content. If you go into general, you're going to have an area where you can do all kinds of suggestions. And if you click in there, you're actually going to find suggestions for things such as forum improvements, homepage improvements, all kinds of stuff. In the fan art section, if you go in there, you're going to find threads to submit logos for the year-end series. You're also going to find threads on pre-stream fan art, montage fan art that I use for the commercial breaks and the montages when I play games. And there's also a thread in there that explains how the heck do I post up pictures properly on this forum. It actually explains to you step by step how to do it. Okay? Now, this is a big one, ladies and gentlemen. Right here, the funniest moments of 2014. I really need people to post up in here. As you can see, we only have 38 replies, so 38 people have posted up their funniest moment nominations, but the thread has over 1,000 views. So tons of people are interested, but almost no one's posting. I need you guys to head over here and post, because I need these as nominations so I can make my funny moments montage. The more, the better, because the more I have to go through, the better chance that I'll get the funniest thing overall. Now, as you can see, other people are talking about other things. Patreon discussion, where people are actively posting up positive suggestions of things that I can do once I join Patreon and things I can give back to the fans and viewers who do Patreon. The gaming schedule update that I posted on the King of Hate vlogs the other day, people are talking about it. I posted it up and people are discussing it. All kinds of stuff. All right? Of course, the constructive criticism thread was already locked because we already had two other threads that were talking about it. It was basically a duplicate thread. Over here, if you get out of that section, further down, excuse me, you've got series. In the series, you've got people discussing all my different series. And in fact, someone just recently posted up quite a good submission for a custom intro for the weekend preview that I may be using this week. I actually liked it so much that I may be integrating it as early as this week. But the reason I'm showing you this, take a look, ladies and gentlemen. Here it is. Ask the King. I'm going to click on this. I just announced tonight on Hate Live that this episode of Ask the King is going to be taking place January 28th, 2015. I need you guys to post up your questions. As you can see, I've only got 55 questions posted. I need more than that. Usually I typically get between 100 to 150 questions. The more the better, because the more questions you post up, the better ones I can pick to make a more entertaining show for you in 2 weeks. So please head over here and post up your questions for Ask the King right here, okay? Going back here, oh, I clicked on the wrong thing. Contest is currently empty because I'm not doing any contests. However, it's very possible that I will be doing more. As you know, at the end of the year, I do the Hardcore Gaming Season giveaway, yada, yada, yada. And then, of course, last but not least, the playthrough section. As you can see, tips and help. There's a tips thread where people are posting up tips for different various games that I've played and some that I haven't. People discussing all my current and ongoing playthroughs, Kingdom Hearts 2.5 Final Mix, the most disappointing games that I put out, this past week. That series, people have discussed it. Dragon Age Inquisition. People basically discussing everything. Okay? So that is the new forums, ladies and gentlemen. And primarily, as I said, what I really need your help with the most right now. Okay? Number one, I need Funniest Moments nominations. That's the big primary number one big thing. Number two, logos and or splash screens for the Game of the Year awards. If you could put those, you saw the sections where you could put those up. Please put those up. Number three, please post up questions for Ask the King in 2 weeks. Number four, Patreon suggestions. I need positive suggestions on what kinds of things I could do for Patreon members that unfortunately doesn't involve Skype, since it seems people seem to continuously be able to get my IP and that's just another way they can get it. A Patreon suggestion. Right? That's the kind of stuff, the feedback that I'm looking from you guys, and that's just going to make everything better this year. The more positive, constructive feedback that I get, the more that I can do for you. But I need your participation. That's why I worked so hard. I spent so much money and, Onyx redesigning the site after it got destroyed, to get it back and reformat it and do a whole new website. This is why we did this. So I hope that you guys will go get over there and use it, and it's going to work out, okay? All right, so now let's close the show. Hold on, because I have to move my microphone back over here now. Let's close the show. Been a long one. As I told you guys, I knew this was probably going to happen and ended up doing a ridiculously long episode, as I figured. All right. So thanks very much, everyone. Now, I can't even see myself. Yeah, it's working. Thanks very much, everyone, for watching Hate Live. I appreciate it. Been a long episode, but it was a very informative one, I hope, for you. Please head over there. Please start posting. Feedback. I can't tell you how useful feedback is, and I need as much feedback as possible to do the best things for you this year. Very shortly, I'll be giving you guys more information on the Patreon that will be launching, but I need your feedback on what to do, what kinds of things do you want from it, etc., etc. All right? I hope that at least some of the explanation that I helped to give tonight lets you know the situation, lets you know exactly why I'm doing it, etc. Spread the word about that, because so many people have been asking me and they get all this misinformation about what Patreon is, or Phil said he wasn't ever going to take donations, yada, yada, yada. I fully elaborated on that tonight, and I hope you'll spread the word about that, okay? And that's about it, everyone. I just want to say thanks very much for watching Hate Live. Have a good night. I will see you guys in 3 weeks. That's right. The next Hate Live will take place in February. That is it for tonight. Peace out. Have a good night, everyone. I'll see you for new gameplay, for more year-end series, and for everything continuing this week. Thank you, and I'll see you later. And now I can't see because I rotated my monitor. I can't end the show because my monitor's rotated the wrong way and I can't control it now from here. So I have to foolishly get up like this. A little botched ending here. Rotate my monitor back like this. Come back over here. Sit back down here. Come over here. Click on this. All right. Good night, everybody.